actually pretty loud on stage.
Yeah, it's pretty loud.
It could be a little quieter, maybe.
I agree. 1-1-1, yeah. Alright.
Not as individuals.
Never again.
I'll be driving the road. You can still have the experience. I touch it. Got Sagara Lai Hodo Tekimo Odo Lock. You are Kinok Shu.
He was born in Tokyo, Japan in 1975 and has grown up in Tanzania, London, San Francisco, and Berkeley, California since he entered high school. In a way, he is a child of diversity of ethnics. His name is Shing02. At the time when my friend Aya first introduced him to me in San Francisco in early spring 2000, I never thought he would be a great subject of my documentary. He looked very quiet and a little bit nervous. He gave no smile at all, which were my first impression of him.
Trailblazing, clinging, everything in sight. Can you hear the bass?
in one word. Come on, right? If nature were our mother, then we're all motherfuckers. And if God were the judge, then everybody would be suckers. Each soul for himself, no matter what team, the formula's the same, competition within. That's my word.
Is as naive and problematic as affirmative action. So calm as you are to shed skin, shed light to the four corners of the world so the story can be told. Sold to the highest bidder of your own soul. Hold, the wine is bitter if you ain't at your goal. So is the epidermis, the permit to perform, but as a hermit, have a chance to earn it. At minimum wage, turning into maximum rage. If I'm a Japanese person doing hip-hop in America, chances are people are gonna be, oh, kamikaze MC, or, you know, whatever, whatever, you know.
You mean the stereotype?
Yeah, stereotyping, basically. So that's kind of what it was, to really, you know, like symbolize, like wherever it's from, sure, but that's like how we, you know, package it. But of course, it's all about the music still, you know, if the music is important, then it's not worth doing.
I was totally shocked when I saw his rap performance Pearl Harbor, because he was the first young guy I'd ever seen who tried to reveal a hidden history of Japan through lyrics. In my school days, they didn't teach me much about the history of Japan during wartime. I believe that to use it for an art form is something like a taboo. He and his lyrics broke this taboo, which triggered this film project.
The background for this project, Pearl Harbor, Japonica EP, basically this was a project that I worked on the second half of 97 and mostly of 98. We worked on it and then we put it out December 7th in Japan to commemorate the attack. And well, basically, you know, originally what had happened was DJ Shin, who made the single, who made the beat for the single, he came over to San Francisco and then he had stopped by Hawaii before that, and then he had, you know, talked about, yeah, you know, he was just at Pearl Harbor, and then just like a summer before that I had been there too, and then after I listened to the beat, you know, I was like, okay, you know, hey, that kind of sounds like a Pearl Harbor beat, you know, it sounds like a pilot, you know, in a cockpit or something. And so the way it started out was really, really casual like that, you know. We were just like, okay, let's just call it the song Pearl Harbor, and then, you know, I'll come up with a concept, and then let's make a single. And that was the extent of it.
Now, it's time to dig into the controversial lyrics of the song Pearl Harbor.
1941, Japanese soldier engaging in battle, perfect composure. Clandestine overnight operation, the final destination, Pearl Harbor. Flying through the night, high visibility, the sky is clear, everything in sight. Can you hear the turbulence? Can you feel my heartbeat? Yo, I'm a lone pilot, equipped with a zero. In my motherland, they honor me as a hero. But I still got my mother's picture in the locket, cause there's nobody else riding in the cockpit. I glance at the panel and the readings are normal. Check the radar, radio detection and ranging. My section is changing, the crew is coming, kamikaze. Direct translation, divine intervention. My squadron comprises an aerial torpedo. I've been taught I'm attacking for Emperor Hirohito. I was raised 22 years so I can serve my one and only country, the Imperial Army. We flew down from the west side of the mountains, the harbor below containing the target fleet. Arizona, Oklahoma, Maryland, and California. Total devastation burnt onto my cornea. I'm dropping bombs on American soil. My blood is getting so heated it's ready to boil and evaporate like the history behind us, to remind us not to forfeit the memories. And yes, I do remember the 7th day of December, being patriotic in an idiotic war. Now what the hell was I fighting for?
But eventually, after we finished the single and we wanted to put it out, you know, my concepts, you know, definitely expanded based on that. And then, you know, I had so many things that I wanted to add on to it, to that concept. And I knew at that time, you know, there would be only so many chances to get everything out that I wanted to say regarding that topic of being Japanese, or, you know, being in the hip-hop game, being Asian, or talking about history, or just, you know, being on that serious note, just to kind of, you know, clear that issue aside before moving on to all these other musical projects that I had in my head. And then that goes for the image too, you know. So a lot of things is represented in this project, and just by using these images, it doesn't really mean that, you know, I'm a right winger or I support the war or I'm actually gonna, you know, bomb anything. It's not like that. This is more like a documentary to me. You know, if PBS or news programs or any TV documentaries have a right to use these images and show the public about the information they want to carry, why can't independent artists like us, you know, do the same thing too? You know, it's not like we took advantage of the image for negative propaganda. You know, it was more like we wanted to be creative, of course, aggressively creative, but at the same time, you know, we really wanted to put a message out there. So that's how, you know, it ended up on this project.
Yo, I'm a low artist building up from zero, with my other hand trying to grab that dinero. I grip the microphone so that I can rock it. Battle drills taught me that I got shit in my cockpit. We throw it down on the west side of the nations, US and Japan, now bringing you the beat. I was on a mission to come to California with the mic while other MCs turn cornea. I don't need a commercial ass single, double platinum, triple six shit, quadruple vinyl to say this much, that I'm the freshest MC ever to touch the mic in this bilingual manner with my own band. I just do what I do and I do well what I do. That's why I move and I dwell with my crew. The name is Empire 22 and don't forget it, I'm concise when I slice, so there's no need for an edit. I think globally and rap locally, yeah. Freak Asian breaking down the equation. E equals MC squared, nah, me equals MC scared, cause I explode atomically. MC break down comically, get dropped automatically. The force connecting the Pacific is called hip hop. One nation indivisible for an invisible war. Now what the fuck are you fighting for? The mic is so hot.
And, you know, as far as that whole issue with the cover art in Japan, you know, when we finished it and sent it, you know, the major distributors didn't want to carry it because not only, you know, this whole war thing, but like copyright issues and many legal issues, but, you know, basically they just didn't want to deal with it. So, you know, that's when we were like, you know, rather than changing it, you know, we'll even make a bigger statement by, you know, saying, okay, we don't want to change it, you know, we'd rather put it out, you know, blank. So the CD cover came out, you know, CD came out, and just no information at all, anywhere. It was just a white booklet with white pages, you know, white everything, and then the CD was just like red with no letters on it. So that's how the CD came out. Let's say take the atomic bomb for example.
Yeah.
There are gazillions of steps that were taken for even the bomb to exist, yeah, until the point that it got dropped. You know, it just didn't happen just because one person said, you know, let's drop a bomb. You know,
yeah,
that's like millions of people involved in that huge process called war. You know, that built up to that point. You know, all the way down to the last moment when the pilot had to drop that thing, you know? You know what I'm saying? It's just like a lot of force,
yeah,
a lot of sheer human energy invested,
yeah,
you know, until it went down like that, you know? So if you look at it like that, then, you know, looking at museums and just witnessing how bad it, you know, humans can be, it's worth it. Then it's worth it, you know.
But I mean, if you just go to a place and then look at all the pieces, you know, like, damn, you know.
Yeah, I mean, if you can piece it together for yourself, but some people are just too dumb, you know, they need to be shocked too.
Yeah.
That's for real, you know.
Mm.
Like, really, how, you know, how much just energy is that to actually, you know, build bombs and spend money on it, and then finance it, budget it, plan it, you know.
Yeah.
train people. It's like a big industry, you know what I'm saying?
Yeah, it's a little bit of government owned industry.
Sponsored, yeah. Right?
In summer of 2000, Shingo took me to a pilgrimage for Japanese ancestry in the United States during World War II. In fact, he'd volunteered for the graphic work of the poster of the tour, so he seemed to be already familiar with the basic concept and purpose of the tour. I thought that the pilgrimage would give me a great chance to grasp the reason why he wanted to make a song Pearl Harbor.
I guess it all started way before I started getting into MCing, which was when I first came here in high school. I was just 15 years old. I didn't really know much about any sort of Asian American communities in America. But fortunately, since I was in California, and especially the Bay Area, I was exposed to all kinds of different cultures. And as far as like the Japanese American history aspect of it, it first started when I first had to research a Supreme Court case for a history class in high school. And then just randomly I happened to pick a case that was about the Japanese internment. So when I got into the research for that homework, I really found out that there were a lot of injustices done to a group of people who just happened to be Japanese. And not just Japanese American, but Japanese people who came to the United States in a way just like I did. And that was a very shocking thing for me to find out something like that.
Even at that, you know, like my mother and them, they didn't know what's going to happen to us or where we're going to go or what we're going to do. So it is, it's an old.
Oh, I see.
For them, it was very, very sad. Sakyomienaika, you know, they were.
So you don't know what's
so
going
we
on.
Were, yeah. So when we got taken to the train station, you know, my mother looked back at the farm and said, "We're not going to see this again," she says, you know. She was right. We never saw the farm again. Because since what you mean, they sold our land. We never got it back.
That even Japanese people had a really difficult history for people to build a community in California. And, you know, also based on the fact that the internment was, the California has this history of, you know, really harsh internment because, you know, it was all about the West Coast and it was close to Japan. So, so that's kind of when I started thinking about me as a Japanese person in America.
Tule Lake was one of the 10 biggest concentration camps in the United States and established in an isolated area near the border between Oregon and California in 1942, following the Japanese attack on Pearl Harbor. After the attack, in addition to the continuous anti-Asian racism for decades in the United States, wartime hysteria and groundless rumors spread over the country. So the government of the United States used the order to force more than 110,000 Japanese residents living in the West Coast to leave their home for one of the concentration camps. But I hear that the 2/3 of them were American citizens. In other words, the government treated the Japanese living in the United States as enemy aliens at the time.
And gradually, as I went on to college, I saw a lot more political people, not necessarily nothing radical or active in the scene, but more people were aware of their backgrounds. I made a lot of friends with Filipino Americans, Indian Americans, Persian Americans, you know, of course, all the black kids, you know, African Americans, Berkeley, Oakland, so. Naturally, you know, it's not so much being caught up in studying the subject. It's like a natural thing to know your history. And so that's just how it started.
Do you wish you had gone to Slocan instead?
Oh yes, I wish that, and even Mom said we wish we would have went to Ghost Town. We could have, I could have finished my high school education, and I could have you know, furthered on then, and not have had to have worked so hard. But before the war, nobody knew what kind of progress we were going to get into. So, you know, that's why we went. My mother took us to the farm community, because of the fact that she had heard so many screwy stories about what was happening.
The showers, they might not be like they're doing, but for 3.5 years. And in the middle of that 3.5 years, not knowing when it would end. So that's kind of the flavor of what it must have been like for people living in the camps at that time.
As we continued the tour of the remnants of the camp barracks, I could vicariously experience Japanese people's lives in these bleak tiny rooms. Suffering from the facts of the attack from their home country and the forced internment by the government authority of the United States, they lost their identities and hope. Tule Lake became a segregation center in 1943 in order to accommodate only the disloyal people to the country. At that point, the government forced all the internees in the 10 camps to declare their undivided loyalty to the United States. The people who refused that were consequently sent into the stockade of Tule Lake, surrounded by high barbed wire fences and 4 machine gun man guard towers. In this way, the unexpected attack on Pearl Harbor caused a crucial experience to Japanese ethnics. Tule Lake was closed in March 1946, and Japanese Americans came to face with the difficulties to reconstruct their lives, because during the internment, they had lost their properties, including houses and farms. After a while, the redress movement of Japanese Americans finally succeeded in making the Civil Liberties Act passed in 1988, which followed the official apology to Japanese Americans by the United States government. Meanwhile, in the first evening of the tour, Shingo joined Tule Lake Youth Group to share their experience and watch their performers.
Just for tonight, if we could just like introduce each other so we could all like know who is who throughout the pilgrimage, and then maybe at the end of the pilgrimage we could come back together. I mean, not just stress y'all's time, but we could come back together and then be like... saved 84 lives and restored hope and faith in all who lived to hear the story. The next day, the Jews were liberated by the Red Army.
Now I realize I'm ashamed to be part of a society that dashes dreams to ashes and laughs at racism that is anything but funny.
Thank you. All suffering sentient beings are liberated and brought to great joy. We sincerely seek the beneficent guidance of the three treasures. In reciting the Maka Hanya Haramita Shingyo, we dedicate its merits to the members of the Japanese American community, and especially to all those who suffered the hardships of internment, to those who suffered the hardships of war, and to those who gave their life for their country. We also dedicate these merits to all those who suffer today from racial and ethnic prejudices. Maka Hanya Haramita Shingyo.
Well, through this few days, I experienced a lot of things. Obviously, I was educated more about the Japanese American experience. I learned a lot of things that I didn't know about, which does make me feel that I want to be more involved in furthering the education of a hidden history. Another thing that I learned was the youth that was involved in this whole organization. Just watching like young teens get up there on stage and give a really good cultural performance, that really, really struck me. Like what they had in their eyes, I really thought I didn't have that energy when I do my show on stage. So that really moved me and really made me want to go back to myself and really somehow, you know, get that positive energy so I could project it towards the crowd, because, you know, I really feel I want to get to that level where I can have people see me and see something through me that I'm trying to do, and not just what I'm saying on the mic, stuff like that. So that was a really good experience. If you want to take the album Pearl Harbor that we did, for example, for me personally, it served two things. One was obviously to represent your history and get the message out there to Japanese kids, American kids, Japanese-American kids, whoever wanted to understand. And through that project, it wasn't necessarily about specifically the Japanese people or the U.S. and Japan. The message behind the whole project was really about peace, about the struggles of people symbolized through war and symbolized through the Pearl Harbor incident. So, you know, it was really a lot of different concepts that were put together that represented a whole bunch of different ideas. And you know, it was really important that we put something very serious together, and it really had a positive, you know, connotation to it. It wasn't really nothing negative to it. So that was one purpose. And the second purpose was that the music that I do is like, it's called hip hop, and it's based on urban experiences of African-American youth starting in New York. And my, as far as me entering into that music, I really wanted to make a statement that I'm not doing something that is foreign to me by, you know, it's really funny. It's almost like I'm not assimilating into black youth culture so that I can have a place in it. I'm doing my thing. Before I do any of the music that I want to do in the future, I'm going to put out this album to say that I'm not hiding the fact that I'm Asian or Japanese. I come from Japan, I represent my background, and I'm doing my thing. So, you know, that was really a big reason behind it. The independent hip-hop vinyl market is like way smaller, and of course it's way more open, you know? Like people can put any vulgar thing on it, they, you know, they'll probably sell more, you know? But for this project, I think, you know, people really appreciated it, you know? Some people didn't understand it, some people thought it's too far-fetched, you know, what does a Pearl Harbor have anything to do with hip-hop? But to me, you know, it has a lot to do with hip-hop because, you know, I'm in the middle of it, you know. I have my background, where I come from, my knowledge, and then I'm, you know, I'm in America representing myself. You know, that was more geared towards people outside of Japan. Like, look, you know, before you put any stereotypes on an Asian person doing hip-hop, I'm gonna take that stereotype, blow it 100 times more, put a lot of message in it, and put it out. You know, in a way, you know, right now I'm doing stuff that's not necessarily about that topic, you know what I mean? So I think there's always a time and place for you to, you know, talk about such subjects.
After the pilgrimage, I have not heard from him for a long while, and I just kept pursuing my own research on his lyrics. In the meantime, I was gradually aware that what he'd been trying to do was not necessarily to raise a political question, but to seek the truth of humanity through music, which is the simplest but the most difficult.
Good night. える音楽はここにある。太陽の下で寝る喜びを味わえば、この歌は歌を書く者たちに捧げたもん。
While I didn't hear from him, the Hollywood movie Pearl Harbor accidentally began to be shown both in the United States and in Japan almost at the same time. On the opening day in Japan, I came across a long line in front of the theater, which reminded me of a crowd of people waiting in the same way in San Francisco. Most of them were not middle-aged or old, but young, who seemed to have little knowledge of the important history concerning Pearl Harbor. They come here just in order to enjoy the movie as an entertainment. I wonder how he feels if he were here, watching the young guys with joyful smiles. After a long period of national isolation for 200 years, the Japanese government attempted to quickly westernize and modernize the country since 1868. Considering the modern Japanese history, you cannot ignore the fact that Japanese people had developed their deep-rooted nationalism under Yamato Damashi, or Japanese spirits, and it was accelerated after Japan's military victories over China and Russia in the 1895 and 1905 wars. Since then, I think Japan began to stray from the right path of its history under the name of expanding Asian prosperity. Even now, there is various kinds of controversy in Japan. For instance, Asian neighbors such as China, South Korea, and other countries are afraid that Japan will go into militarism again. For the Prime Minister and some cabinet members still pay homage to this shrine for the war dead, including Class A war criminal. This is one of the symbolic exhibits in the shrine, which shows us a kamikaze pilot's last words to his parents just before going into battle, titled "See You Again at the Yasukuni Shrine." From these words, you might find not only how sincerely the soldiers accepted their destiny to die for the country, but also how strongly they treasured humanity like family bonds. And I guess Shingo was deeply inspired by the soldiers' words to make his lyrics. In 1945, Japan finally surrendered, and then the occupation government of the United States began to democratize and Americanize the nation of Japan. And they also established a lot of military facilities with which Japanese self-defense force came to collaborate. Nowadays, the United States utilizes these facilities as a relay point of their operation related to the dispute with the Middle East. I heard later that he was focusing on making his music in Tokyo while we had no communication. That was his first time to stay in Japan for such a long period, so I think he could mix his philosophy with the new experiences. he encountered in Japan and undoubtedly bring about more profound lyrics.
Well, patriotism to me definitely means a lot of different things to a lot of different people. Of course, it means a lot of different things when you're in different countries, you know. But it almost seems in the Western world, patriotism is means, you know, American or USA, or, you know, not just recently, but it just seems like that. You know? But that has a lot to do with history, you know, how people define themselves, being coming from a certain area or certain country, or coming up from a certain race, or it means sometimes it's a definition of whether you're accepted to the whole or the mass consciousness of that country. You know, especially in America, we have all kinds of different races, and people are always trying hard to be accepted. The mainstream, you know.
Hi.
But nowadays, you know, the minority makes up the majority. So it's definitely changing, you know, what it means to be patriotic. But to me, even if in Japan, you know, being patriotic to me just means like, just, you know, at least adding something new to the whole, not just being absorbed into the whole, you know. To me, being patriotic is going outside of the country, bringing back something new so that people appreciate you. But that's really taking care of your country. Of course, you can stick to your, you know, home ground and, you know, grow vegetables or whatever. You know, that's good too. But in this day and age, you have to go outside and represent yourself, represent your country, you know, bring something back for the younger kids, inspire them, you know. That's what's needed. In Japan, you know, that's what's needed. A lot of people are, you know, too conservative to realize that. They think it's not necessary, but it is.
Oh!
Trying to write in two different languages is like a totally different process. Trying to write in Japanese or try to write in English, sometimes you don't even require a subject, but you just keep writing, almost like poetry. Or sometimes, you know, people compare it to spoken word or whatever. But when it comes to rapping, you know, that's like a whole different history behind it. So you really have to have some sort of knowledge or respect to that art form when you are, you know, you're basically participating in like a whole history of vocal techniques, but at the same time you're trying to maximize your experience into the art that you're reflecting yourself onto. So basically, you know, language, a word, vocabulary is actually limited. It can be confined in, you know, by definition or fit into the volume of a dictionary, but the way in which you use it is infinite. The combination is infinite. Doesn't necessarily mean to grab the microphone and rock a crowd. Rap means to talk, speak your mind. And that is like a, you know, really big step that people take before expressing yourself in any medium. Just speaking your mind, being able to express your ideas without fear of being rejected or without, you know, the fear of being, you know, labeled or criticized or what have you. But, you know, just having the courage to speak out is a big thing, it's a great thing, I believe. It's really positive. Because even if it's extreme, you know what I mean? Like, if you have like a certain energy to what you're saying, some people might actually be, you know, influenced by it. Or even if they don't agree with you, they might respect you still. As long as your energy is going in the right direction, chances are the words that will come out of you are in the lines of what you're trying to do. Therefore, people might agree with you and then help you out. And then people, you know, people will work together to do something even bigger. Because you can't do everything by yourself. Therefore, you know, it's always a start to put something out with your voice on it, you know, which you can't do with pictures. You have your own voice. And if you really believe in what you're doing, you know, people will sense that.
400という曲をやりたいと思います。 これは本当にこのいろいろイベントやっていく中でもうテーマソングみたいな感じでずっと歌詞が頭の中になっているような感じなんで、まあ、とりあえず聴いてください。 今日に100地図目に煮詰めて己を見つめて言葉を縮めて400世の中の嘘を800真っ二つに切る言葉400 地図面に煮詰めて己を見つめて言葉を沈めて400潰れるマスコミ広がる口コミビートを打ち込み鉛の筆日だまりの木の下でたまりにたまった気持ちをはくたくさんの感情をかき分け先駆けてたどり着く本音とんでもなくでかい問題の気配に囲まれて暮らす社会途方もなく虚しく感じさせる生きがいのつかめない実態では一体働くこととは何かと一から考え直せば頭と体を奉仕する息生活を維持する実感道具と時間と環境を揃えば何でもできるかといえばそれは違う何もかもダメ嫌な仕事をするはめ全ては飯を食うためだけ誰も彼もお金が悩みの種のおかげ貯めても取られるだけだから人間やめってバカな真似そう簡単死ねない血と肉とね中に宿る心子供の頃の夢をここで呼び起こすところえい400地爪に詰めて己を見つめて言葉を沈めて400世の中の嘘を800真っ二つに切る言葉400地爪に詰めて己を見つめて言葉を沈めて400潰れるマスコミ広がる口コミビートを打ち込み若い人間しかできないことできない仕組みでへつらい溺愛する権力なんて結局積極的な個性も殺す漏れる実力新しい価値掲げる若手を旗手に結束固めて逆らう力を蓄え仲間と輩を片手でまとめてもう一方で逃げる舞台仕切る隠れてる黒幕の尻尾今日日本を動かすのんきな大人も明日は一言じゃねえぞ若い人間にも一言親離れをするまでまだ半人前一人前の飯平らげるだけ下の手本になること自覚しろ2人前の稼ぎできるまでは1人の女も守れないから3人前の責任背負えば家族の周知を1人で守る宝だから1人身の内道を極めろ選択する覚悟しろ衣食住だけ確保しろ随時選択やってるやつ手を挙げろ400地爪に煮詰めて己を見つめて言葉を沈めて400世の中の嘘を800真っ二つに切る言葉400地爪に煮詰めて己を見つめて言葉を沈めて400潰れるマスコミ広がる口コミビートを打ち込み最新の機械の使い方も理解できない大人が牛耳る世界最近の若い世代の扱い方知らない本当なら怖いなのに臭いものに蓋ハンスだけ無駄知ったか流行りの歌ちょっと待ったそれで終わりかだからお互い分かち合うのは同じ文化の違う世代よりも違う文化の同じ世代そういう時代何が大事か誰か間近見切りつける締め切りも間近これから始まる話に恥も外部も大気名分もなければこの国の端と端から集まる子たちが命を懸けては一人変われば周りの100人変える力持つこと忘れんな長いものはぶった切る出る杭は打ち返す芸術で訴える400地爪に詰めて己を見つめて言葉を沈めて400世の中の嘘800万二つに切る言葉400地爪に詰めて己を見つめてって言葉を沈めて400長いものはぶった切る出る杭は打ち返す芸術で訴える長いものはぶった切る出る杭は打ち返す芸術で訴えるどう
now invite you to bend down and touch our Mother the Earth if possible. And Grandfather, in touching our Mother, everything we live and do and move has its moments on top of our Mother the Earth. All goodness comes from her. If in any way we have violated her, damaged her, or harmed her, we are resolved not to do it again. Grandfather, we believe we come from the earth, and when we die, our family return us to our mother so that we may once again be nurtured and return to you. Grandfather, the rain falls on our mother, the flowers and the grass grow. Grandfather, we thank you and we praise you for the gift of our Mother the Earth. And now we stand and we behold Grandfather himself in the universe.
Population.
One mind, one nation.
Welcome to my nation, where I'm the king and the president, prime minister to a minister. Do you know what my vision is? That everybody realizes that their vision is capable of having positive answers. If you got a fraction with a strong denominator, do you know what my vision is? That every soul realizes that their vision is capable of having positive outcomes. If you are the fraction with a strong denominator, we are the nominators of equality. No matter what denomination, race, creed, or political belief, communication is the critical relief for solving situations suffering from separation. Millions lost in the minions go back to the sovereign land for reunion. The facts we are one despite unique opinions. When you discover the roots of pale skins like an onion, the most high. Minister, daily politics. American relief for solving situations, suffering for separation. Millions lost in the minions go back to the sovereign land for reunion. The facts we are one despite unique companions. When they discover the route to pale skins like an onion, the most high.
久しぶりですね。
そうですか。
日本はもうどれくらい？
日本はちょうど1年。
ちょうど1年。
はい、
去年の今頃帰ってきた。
はい、
アメリカに行って。そうすると、1年、まあ、その前はしばらくずっと日本に結構長くいたでしょう。
はい、
どうですか、1年逆にアメリカに戻ってみて、何かこう、リフレッシュできましたか、ね、
それはどっちの国に対して？
アメリカに対して。
あ、うん、やっぱアメリカに帰りたての頃は、すごく懐かしかったですね。うん、
やっぱり過ごした時間が圧倒的に長かったからって思う。
だけど、まあ、いつも運がいいんですけど、ちょうどいい時期に行ったり来たりできてるので、僕がアメリカ離れた時期は本当に、まあ、経済もすごい遅かったし、同時にやっぱテロの事件も偶然あって、いろいろあったんで、なんか僕は友達とかと再会しても、この1年何やったって言っても何もなかったっていう人が多かった。
あ
だからあんまり離れてたっていうのは全然なかったですね。逆になんかちょっとタイムマシンでどっか行って戻ってきたっていう感じでした。それぐらいなんか変な感じでした。すごい静かな感じでした。
でもそれはすごく、まあ、今シンガーとかラッキーだよね、うん、この今のなんかいろいろ、まあ事件とかそういうのも含めていろんなことがいっぱい動いてるじゃないですか。そういう中でそういう気持ちを保てるっていうのはある意味すごく幸せだよね。でもどうなんだろう、客観的には見れるわけじゃん、物事。音楽もそうだし社会もそうだし、あのもちろん静かにいれる分いろんなものを見てると思うんだよね。そういう中で何かアメリカに行って、じゃあ逆に日本のことって何か思い出したり気になったりとかしたら、
まあ、アメリカに住みながら日本のことを考えると言っても、まあ、実際に帰ってこないと分からないことが本当にあるので、やっぱ日本っていうのは情報として、まあ、見たり聞いたりしてても、実際に成田空港に着いて、ああ日本っていうのがあれだから、うん、やっぱ遠いなとは思いますね。本当にニュースとしていろいろあれが起きたこれが起きたっていうのは聞くことができても、やっぱり雰囲気だけは戻ってこないと分からない部分が非常に大きいと思います。
やっぱり距離ってすごい、まあ、大事っていうか重要な要素だよね。なんか物事を捉えるときに、それこそフィジカルに捉えるのとそうじゃないのっていう、それこそ情報はどこでも得られるから生活してる国はあるし、それはやっぱり信号はやっぱり行ったり来たりっていうのはやっぱりすごい人生の中で結構あると思うので、そういう要素って結構信号の中にいっぱいあると思うので、そのやっぱりインターグラウンドっていうか、じゃあ今回日本帰ってきて、まあ帰ってきて、まあまだ何日か経ってないけど、どうだろう、みんなとまた再会して、
まあ実を言うと、まあ、僕が変わったのかわからないんですけど、日本帰ってきて、まあすごいいい意味なんですけど、なんでか知らないけどすごいゆったり感じるんですよね、どこ行っても。それはなんでかなと思いましたね。それは、まあ、友達とかとも話してて、それは全体的にみんなが質素になったのか、まあ、忙しい人は気づいてないかもわかんないですけど、でもなんとなくみんなゆったりしてる風に映りました、僕の目には。
なんだろうね、そこをちょっともうちょっと聞きたいな、ゆったりっていうのは。時間のペースのことですね。
なんか、まあ、あんまギスギスしていないというか、 逆にやっぱアメリカが最近ギスギスしてきてるから日本に来てホッとしたのかもしれないですし、まあ、特に僕の住んでいるカリフォルニアではいろんなことあったし、この1年は。
でもどうなんだろう、まあ、そういうアメリカでも、まあ、やっぱりさっきも言ったけど、そういうのは結構育ってきた環境っていうことだから、そういうアメリカがそういうふうにやっぱり東京より落ち着いたんですよ。
まあスペースはやっぱ圧倒的に向こうの方が広いですけど、逆にアメリカは本当に一人の時間も多いし、まあそれは良くも悪くも働くと思うんですけど、本当に集中もできるけど本当に自分の仕事のペースが誰にも左右されない分、怠けちゃう分もすごい多いから、まあ日本はやっぱ人のつながりとかで動いてるから、その分刺激もされると思うし責任もあるから、だまあアメリカは本当隠居生活みたいな感じですね。みんな、だから西海岸でもそういうのが嫌な人は東海岸とか行ったり来たりするし、まあそれからロサンゼルスか、
まあ良し悪しだよね。
そうですね。やっぱり人間は案外あの大きいことを言ってでも自分の身近なことに対してはすごい耳近かったりするじゃないですか。だから、例えばどんなに社会がとか言っても自分の家族とか友達とちゃんと関係を持てない人はやっぱどこか問題があると思うし、だそういう意味でね、僕は結婚もしたし、結構前からベジタリアンにもなって、なんていうのかな、だから例えば欲っていうものは我慢するものじゃなくて逆に持たなければ苦労しないと思うから、だから欲は持ち続けて禁欲と思ってたら、そういう人間の基本的な欲あるじゃないですか、食欲とかもそうだし、そういうものはなんかそういう悪循環良くないと思うんですよ。なんか自分で我慢してそれでもやって、それで罪悪感を持ってって、なんかそういうのじゃなくて、本当にそれをそれで苦労したくないんだったら、もう初めからそういう欲を、小さい欲を重ねないことです。知ったら本当に最後に自分の基本としてある欲が、自分が何をしたいのかっていうのがだんだん分かる気がするし、他の人のことも気にならなくなると思います。
そういう自分が今現実にあるんじゃないか。
それはないですけど、
これからの、
うん、
でも思わないとならない。
まあもちろん生活もしなきゃいけないし、それは現実ですから。でも僕の周りの人はやっぱり本当フリーランサーが多いというか、みんな自分の好きなことをしつつどうやってでその折り合いをつけていこうかっていうことですから。まあやっぱ仲間は大切だし家族も大切ですから。
まあ、さっきさ、またテープ一回止めたときにさ、欲の話とかも結構したじゃない。
結構してる。
で、まああの、今回ドロッピンリリックスっていうのを撮らせていただいて、で、まあちょうどあれ終わった後にアメリカがアフガンに攻めていったりとか、イラクに行ったりとかいろいろあって、まあ、やっぱりそれもさっきの話のその欲とかそういったこととね、 すごいなんか関係あるよなとかって思いながらここまで来たんだけど、
はい、
どうかな、実際アフガンの頃にはもうアメリカに帰ってたんだよね。そうだよね、今年の3月。いい
あ、どう、アフガニスタンは2002年の
話。あ、2002年か。
だからそっちに。
そうかそうか。アフガンとイラクは向こうにいたのね、はい、うん、どういう風に感じました、その後ああいったことが、まあ大きな動きが今2回続いてるんだけど、どんな風に感じてますか。
いや、 やっぱりだから我々一般市民としては本当にそういう、まあ、戦争というアイデアに賛成したり反対したり、特定の政治家を攻撃したりっていうのはすごい簡単なんですけど、やっぱり何が真実なのかっていうのは本当に見極めるのが難しいと思います、ね、うん、だから僕の周りでも本当はこうなんだとか、こういう理由があるんだとか、陰謀説がどうだとかいろいろありますけど、そういった中でもなんでそういうことが起きてしまうのかっていうのは、ある意味その国というかその人々が作っている国だから、人々がそれを反映しているとも言えると思いますけど、だから例えばアメリカがこうこう言ってアメリカ人があの誰が良くないとか言うじゃないですか。だけどそれはもうその国の代表なんだから、もうその国のシステムで選ばれた人なんだから、それはその人たちにも反映されることだと思うんですけど、だから日本の対応がこうだこうだって言ってもそれは日本人を反映していることだと思う。
結構じゃあ一般市民の人たちのそういう意識みたいなものも影響してるっていうことなのかな。
僕はそう思いますね。だからああだこうだ言いますけど、個人レベルでは自分はこう思うとか、こうではこんなこと言ってたって、だけどやっぱ最終的には全員に責任が思いますけど、
あのちょうどシンゴはアメリカに行ってからサンフランシスコですごい大きいデモンストレーションっていうか、それに参加したっていうふうに、参加するって言ってたよね、あのユニオンストリートだっけ、マーケットストリートか、そういうすごい大規模ないわゆるデモンストレーションってあまり日本では最近はそれこそあるけども、そういうとこに、まあ、参加してたって聞いたんだけど、実際どうですか、そういう人の中にいて、自分がそういうポジションにこう自分からボランティアっていうか入ってって。
まあそこはさっき言ったすごいトリッキーなところなんですけど、実際にそのデモに参加している人たちは参加する余裕がまだ生活にあるからしているという皮肉もありですね。まあ、そういう意見をあの、まあ、表現するってことはすごいお互いのため、その横のつながりのためにはすごい大事だと思いますし、意義はすごいあると思います。だからといってそんなに真面目腐ったものでもないし、やっぱそのみんなすごいエモーショナルになっているから、それを表現する場っていうのがあって、結構ポジティブな雰囲気でしたけど、
それなんだろう、やっぱりこう生活と密着してるっていう感覚があるのかな、やっぱそういうすごい対峙してる問題と、その大きな問題と自分がいる道っていうのが近いってすごい感じてるのかな、そういう人たちだから。すごい、
まあアメリカの場合はあの特にデモとか起こり始めた時に、本当にあのなんでみんながそんな起こり始めたかっていうと、やっぱりアメリカのそういう政府の一方的なあの政策と、そういうあのやっぱ まあ、予算とか、まあ、そういうことも含めてどんどんあのローカルの先生の首が切られていったり、そういうところでやっぱ貧富の差が広がっていくってことにみんな危機感を覚えたんだと思うし、実際にあのこれだけリッチな国がなんでそんな一般の人たちが苦しんでいる国に攻撃しに行くのかっていうところが許せなくて、まあ、そういう正義のためにこれはフェアじゃないっていうのをみんな言いに来たかったなと思うんですけど、まあ、そういう雰囲気でした。
そういう人の動きっていうのはやっぱり実際社会を変えていくっていうか、そういうものに確実につながっていくっていう確信みたいなものとか、こうそういうものってあったし、ね、特に参加して
て、それは何とも言い難いですけど、そういうことがあったということはすごいいろいろな人の個人の活動のためにはすごいなると思いますけど、それが原因で何か変わったっていうのは測れないものだと思います。だから例えば、まあ、あの今年の9月の11日にその僕の友達のアン・リンさんという人がそういう平和運動をしていて、まあ、テロ2周年ということですね。それで新聞にも載ってテレビ局も来ていろいろやってたんですけど、実際に一般の人の関心っていうのはごく薄いし、同時にあの他に行われた行事もほとんどなかったですし、何なんでしょうねって感じでしたね。だからもちろんその間に戦争があったから、あの9月11日の事件といつまでもそういうことに浸ってられないっていう感じでしたね。
現状はやっぱり今そういうイラク問題とかそういった方にアメリカの人たちがバーッと向いちゃってる感じな
の。だからなんか問題自体がすごい複雑なのに、それをすごい白か黒かではっきり決めちゃうっていうこと自体がもうアメリカのやり方だから、その間の100通りの意見を無視しちゃうと本当に何も解決しないと思うんですよね。だからそれがメディアのやり方じゃないですか、いいのか悪いのかみたいな。だから僕があの平和の、まあ、ピースクレーンのイベントでいた時もインタビューされて、まあ、ニュースだからしょうがないんですけど、そのキャスターの人が9月11日のテロの後、戦争にあのつながってそれが実は良くないという意見もありますがどう思いますかみたいな質問をするんですよね。なんて答えていいのかわからない、戦争が悪いという人もいるようですがっていう質問にはね、なんて答えていいのかわかんないですよね。それでなんかすごいレッテルを貼りたがるっていう、じゃああなたはあのことはピースアクティビストと呼んでいいですかみたいな。でもいや別に僕は普通に自分の意見としてやってるわけだから、もちろん呼ばれることは構わないんですけど、だからといってわかります、それが仕事としてやってるわけじゃないし、だから僕がいつも思うのはそういうあのアメリカ人が自分の旗を振ったりそういう愛国心をあの見せることも簡単だけど、同時に自分の意見をきちんと言ってちょっとしたそういうデモに参加するなりそういう行動を起こすこともそんなに難しいことじゃないし、それを時間取るわけでもないから、やっぱり何もしないよりかはいいとは思いますけど。
でもどうだろう、実際そうね、あのこのドキュメンタリー撮らせてもらってからもう何だかんだ言って1年2年ぐらい経つんだけど、もうそういうもろもろ社会も動いてたりとか、信号の中でも変化があったりとかして、まあ音楽活動の方でそういういろんな経験とか環境の変化とかそういったものが またやっぱり音楽の中に入っていくと思ってるんだけど、どうですか最近音楽を作っていて、明らかにまた、確か俺がインタビューしてる頃ってその今はヒップホップっていうものをやっていて、でもそれは次のいろんな形の音楽を作っていきたい、その一つのステップストーンみたいな、別にそこに区別をするわけじゃないけども、とにかくそのいろんなことのまずはそのなんていうかステップストーンっていうような感じのことを言ってたのを覚えてるんだけど、でアルバムをまたいろいろ作ったりとかね、活動をやってると思うんだけど、どうだろう実際のその音楽の中での変化っていうか歌詞とか。
まあ、実を言うと今は前からそれは思っていたことなんですけど、ヒップホップを今まで作ってきたわけですけど、とりあえずサンプリングという手法を一度置いてちゃんと自分で一から組み立てていこうっていうことを考えているんですけど、大まかに言うとそのなんだろう、カット&ペーストっていうコンセプトにすごい疲れてですね、自分がなんかもっとオリジナルになんかオーガニックにやる方法はないかっていうことをすごい感じるようになったので、それを念頭に置いて勉強をしている最中なんですけど、機材だったりエンジニアリングだったり音楽だったりとそんな感じですね。それは結構でかいですね。やっぱり人のものをコピーしてペーストしてっていう考え方が、ヒップホップだけじゃないですけど、そういうサンプリングという考え方が一時期すごい流行ったと思うんですよね。いや、ヒップホップのすごい一番の良さでもあるんですけど、その何でもありっていうそのコンビネーションを探すことがいわゆる DJ 的な作業で、新しい雰囲気を生み出すっていうのはすごいヒップホップのパワーだったと思うんですけど、どんな音楽理論にも縛られないし、歌でもないし会話でもないけども、この何なんだろうっていうのが、だけどあまりにもそのコピー&ペーストのアイディアが氾濫しすぎてすごい薄っぺらくなっちゃったと思うんですよね。で僕自身もなんかすごいそういう風に物事を考えるようになっちゃって、あまり物事を鑑賞してもちゃんと味わえなくなっちゃったんですよ。これ本当に大げさな話じゃなくて、なんか映画を見たりしてても、あ、これ使えるとか、あ、これサンプリングできるとか、人の話を聞いてても、あ、このネタは使えるなとか、そういう風に考えるようになっちゃうんですよね。だからそれはグラフィックでもそうだし、あ、これ見た、これ写真撮っといて、なんか多分使おう。自分で絵を描こうと思うんじゃなくて、なんか何でもかんでもコラージュみたいに考えちゃうと、その手法が斬新なうちはすごい楽しいんですけど、それはずっと続くかもしれないですけど、あるレベルでは。だけど、自分の感じにくっつけようとしてるピースがそういうものだけでできてるってことに、少々疲れたっていうか、だからといって自分がやってきたことを否定するわけじゃないし、そういう作品がいいなとも思いますけど、同時に例えば誰かがすごいサンプリングとかを上手にやったビートとか、グラフィックとか見てもあんま感動しなくなりました。そんだったらもっと下手でもいいから、それかもっとベテランじゃなくても若い人でもいいから、なんかもっとオリジナルで素朴なものの方がかっこいいなと思います今は。そういう変化ありますね。だ今はもうまだそういう実験中なんですけど、だヒップホップを軸にもっとジャズとダブがあって、それはすごい相対的だと思うんですけど、なんか即興性とかその手で やるこの生々しい感じっていう意味ではすごい似てると思うんですよね。だからそういうのを目指してて、はたまたでも機材とか使 使っていくとどうしてもね、やっぱ電子音楽とかそういう部分はどうしても出てくるから、まあ、難しいですけど、それにその上にまあ言葉っていう部分もあるし、言葉もやっぱりカットのペースだけじゃなくて、今まではそういう日本語でラップしたり歌したりっていうのがすごい実験的だったから、自分にとってはこの言葉を引用するだけでかっこいいみたいなのですごい満足した部分が、今はたとえ自分が何回も使った言葉でもこう言えば新しく言えるんじゃないかとか、使い古された言葉でもなんかもっとしっくりくるんじゃないかって、そういう風に考えれるようになったと思うんですけど、だからあんまカット&ペースで考えると、一回使っちゃった言葉はもう二度と使いたくなくなるんですよね。あ、もうこれ一回やったからいいやっていう、それはテーマにしてもそうだし、あ、これはもう一回やった曲だからもう一回やり直しても意味ないやって、そういう風に思っちゃうとすごいもったいない。人間関係においてもそうだし、もうちょっとペースダウンしてでもいいから、じっくりと自分のためにいいものを